Thank you. morning, church. Yesterday evening, Pastor Tim talked about the blessing of the Sabbath. And I don't know if you're feeling it today, but I know I am. When Friday night hits, I just feel that blessing roll over me. And it lasts all day. Let's begin our worship today, praising God.
Infinite Father, faithfully loving your Jesus, what a friend for sinners. Welcome to Niles Westside. I wanted to say thank you to a few people this week. One is our everybody that's helping out with the sound and media. Thank you guys. You guys do a great job. Once in a while, if you're up front, you'll have to email something back and forth or get some help with the sound media. We have a great team. I really appreciate all of you guys, how responsive you are and how smooth everything works. So thank you for the help. And I wanted to thank you today. In the Sabbath schools, we have some excellent musicians, some piano players, and sometimes you play week to week, and it might almost feel like it gets old, right? When you're a good piano player, you're playing for the kids, some of the same songs. But thank you to everybody who's helping out in the classes. And we're excited today that the Niles School is singing. The Niles School, the kids are excellent active listeners. They're so quiet up here. It's like they know how to do it. So I know going into Sabbath school class, everybody's so energized and ready to go. But see, you guys prove it. Look how quiet you can be. You guys are silent as mice up here. So great job. We're excited to hear them as they get a little louder as they're singing. And today I wanted to go over a few things I was researching. I was thinking about ways, we live in 2024, it can be a little difficult or maybe even awkward to invite people over or hang out with people. And some of us, I kind of like time to myself, but some of us like more time around people. So this might be tips for people that like to hang out with people. But I looked up some of the most popular ways to invite somebody over if you wanted to hang out with somebody. And as I was coming through church today, I already saw some church members, maybe people that are visiting for the first time, and I was listening, I was passing them in the hall, and they were talking to people, getting to know people. So if you're a visitor at Niles today, welcome, we're really glad you're here. And I'm gonna talk about some ways we can connect. This isn't just for members too. Sometimes if you're the new person coming into a business environment, wherever it is, sometimes you kind of have to welcome yourself, right? And connect with people. So it can go both ways. So here's some, I'm gonna say top 10 ways we can connect with people. I did make sure there wasn't anything that said like meet at the bar or anything like that. So this is a kosher list for the most part here. Okay, so for the first one here, there was movie marathon, all right? Hard to get to know people if you're watching a movie marathon, but that was on the list, so I won't leave it out. Going to a museum together. Going to a coffee shop, it says. I'm not a huge, like, go out and eat. Here's another one, having a game night. So get together with people, have a game night of some sort. Hosting a potluck. We do those here. So that's one of the top 10 ways here, hosting a potluck. Besides church, there's not that many opportunities to connect and have potluck. Another one is host a spa day. That's probably a great men's get together there, hosting a spa day. Doing a painting studio, joining with a group. Going out and having a park day. Better get those in before it gets cold. And then cooking classes, it says. So that was the list that Google gave to me. So it gives us some ideas. If you come across somebody, maybe you're somebody that's even feeling a little bit lonely, you might decide to do one of these activities to connect with people. So with that being said, let's get into, I'm gonna go to the back of our bulletin, and we have some highlights to talk about at church today. One of those is after church, come over to NAS, that's the school across the parking lot, and join us for a wonderful meal, fellowshipping with friends. So there we go, there's an opportunity for us. We're also in the midst of our Discover Prophecy seminars. So those are going on right here at the church. In each of the bulletins, we have a pamphlet here that talks about the seminars. And it looks like tonight the topic will be the greatest religious cover-up. So check your bulletin, pull out that flyer if you want to see more information about those meetings. Please keep those involved in prayer. It says especially the guest, and may God continue to bless these meetings. This month is Pastor Appreciation Month. So I don't think our pastor, I don't know if he's here or not, we'll just act like he's not. If anybody can think of anything wonderful and great that pastor has done that's been affecting us, if we just want to give a word of encouragement. We do have prayer slips in all of our pews. They are meant for prayer. Maybe the pastor needs some prayers as well. But if you wanted, you could fill out on one of those slips a thank you, a kind word, and slip it into the pastor's office. There's a little cubby on the door that's just right next to the office. What a good way we could think of something, anything that the pastor's done to encourage us. We could just slip that in here the entire month, and he would probably like to read it and see those things. You think sometimes as a leader, you hear some encouragement, but sometimes we forget, right? You're assuming somebody else did it. So any words of encouragement, we could send those, we could drop those right into the cubby on his door. Community services. There's residents. We're helping. It says we're very appreciative of food donations. We help about 25 individuals each month with providing them with food and things that they need. Most live and appreciate ready-to-serve or easy-to-serve meals. That would include shelf-stable milk, granola bars, canned soup, fruit, peanut butter, and jelly. And they also would appreciate any dish soap, tissues, toilet paper. And if you have any of those things you would like to give, could I ask somebody in the church, where's the best drop-off point for those types of things? If I was to bring something to church next week, where could those things be put? Where at? The front entrance as you're coming in, right? There's some tables set there. If anybody has any of those items, you can drop it off there right as you're coming in. Okay? And then last, we have some prayer requests for Don Hilliard. His family has said thank you to everybody for their prayers. He's doing as well as can be expected. Visits are appreciated for Don. Jane Ringler and family and the loss of their sister, Kathy. Joseph Minks, who's the son of Jess and Kelly, he is recovering from surgery after his work injury and would like continued prayers. So please keep those things in mind. I'm gonna say a prayer for us here, so if we can bow our heads. Dear God, I just wanna pray as we enter into this worship time. Thank you for allowing and giving us this time where we can get together, we can put you first, and we can worship you as your creation. Lord, I want to pray that all of us can be open-minded to the words that we hear today. Thank you for the fellowship and opportunity that we have to meet and connect with others, whether it's in church, at potluck, or throughout the week. And we want to thank you for all of the help, whether it's the music, the Sabbath school rooms, the technology that makes it work. Thank you for the willing people that are a part of putting and making this service go on so that we can all join in. Lord, we want to pray for the kids as they sing today. Thank you for their voices and their willingness. And we look forward to what you have in store for us. In your name, amen. I just want to invite Pastor up today. Our offering is for World Budget, so we're going to be passing around an offering.
Thank you very much, Tyler. We are going to have a mission focus on El Salvador. We received some news from them this week, and we have not heard from them for a long time. Due to the fact they are raising some more money for their labor. In the spring of this year, we sent them about $10,000 into this project, El Clamor Final Church, which is translated as the Final Call Church. Some of you were able to be there with us when we went there in the spring. So the people have received the money, and they put their hard work into it, and they almost have completed the building, just almost. And right now they're kind of in a pause stage because they do need some money to be raised for the labor. And in the meantime, as they are doing the fundraising, they are actively doing the work of God. They are involved in the work of evangelism. We do have evangelism going on right now in our church. Praise the Lord. And please feel free to join our series. Pastor Tim, thank you so much for leading out at that. Don't hesitate to come and support our meetings and bring some more people so that they hear the messages. These people in El Clamor Final, they also do their work of evangelists. And this is how they did it. They live in a poverty-stricken community. And just one of the ways to reach out to people is to teach them some skills they could use to generate some income. And the women from this church have taken about 30 women total from the community and took them to a kind of a conference-owned place like we have in Campus Harbor, where they do have some seminars, and they taught him how to saw over there in that place. And about 10 ladies, after attending this workshop, they have decided to take Bible studies. Isn't that amazing? That is great. This is a 30, 40 members church, and they are doing such a great work. And these are the pictures from that. And they also share some secrets how they could produce a more income for their own families. And this lady, her name is Marina, and she came to church out of a curiosity and got some friends in the church. And this is what one of the ladies taught her in the church, you know, that said, you know, you could dye the t-shirts, and by doing this, you could help your family. And this is what this lady has been doing, and she's so grateful to the church, to people there, for giving her this ability. So, my friends, the opportunity for us to witness, to share the Word of God, comes from little things. The seed of the gospel could be shared in the time when you help somebody to generate their income. So, thank you very much for your generosity, for the fundraising that we had in the spring and send the money over there. They, I can't wait for them to give me a call and tell me we are ready to dedicate this building. And very soon that will happen. But in the meanwhile, please pray for reaching out efforts of evangelism in that church and in also our church here as well. Thank you for your prayers.
Good morning. It's time for the children's story. And so please, as you come up for the children's story, go ahead and collect the money that's out. And feel free to take the scenic route and go up and down all of the different aisles of the church, because there are lots of people that want to contribute money towards our students and education. Thank you. Today happened about 10 years ago. Mom, it is so hard to be away from home. This was Sherry's first time away from home, and she was at Indiana Academy. And she said, Mom, I miss all my friends from Oregon. I'd like to go back to Oregon. We said, Sherry, you're doing so well here. I know, but I miss my friends. So I went to my class, because when I need help with things, I go to my class. And my class of third and fourth graders, they made cards and drew pictures, and they even did some origami things. There were some cute little square pigs with little square snouts and little square legs that went down to her in a box, along with some treats. Oh, she was so excited to get that. She didn't know those kids, but she loved the cards and the message, and she especially loved those little pigs, because it was just something she could put on her shelf and look at and know that there were people that cared about her and were thinking about her. And then a few years later, my phone rang in my classroom, and Sherry has a particular ring that is on my phone, so I always know when it's Sherry calling. And when she calls, I answer. And I answered, and she said, Mom, I really need help. I need you to pray, because I've studied really hard for my test, but I don't know if I'll remember everything. And I said, you know what? We will pray, and I'm gonna ask my class to pray with me. So my whole class, we all closed our eyes, and we prayed that Sherry would be able to remember everything that she had learned. And you know what? She did. And she called us back a few days later, and she said, Mom, I got an A on my test. And I was on the phone, and my class couldn't hear her, but they could hear me. And I said, you got an A on your test? And do you know what my class did? They cheered, they clapped their hands, and they cheered for her. And that really spoke to her heart. In fact, 10 years later, 8 years later, she's remembering these little things that my class did for her. Do you know that even as kids, you can make a difference in other people's lives, and you can help them to know that they are loved. You can help them know that Jesus loves them by praying with them and sharing Bible verses and just encouraging them. And so today, I want you to look for people that you can encourage, because when you encourage people, they remember that for a long time. You can impact their lives. Do I have someone who is willing to say a prayer for us? You'd like to? All right.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you for everything that you've done for us. Please be with us on your beautiful Sabbath day. Lay our angels around us. Help anybody who has something on their hearts today, and help them know that they are loved by you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. You may walk back to your seats now.
To admit that I'm feeling like a guilty American right now because I'm feeling a little uninspired to vote this year. I don't want to know who feels the same. But you know, I realized that I have an opportunity every day to vote for something that I believe in. You see, prayer is like voting. Prayer is voting for the presence of God in your life. Prayer is voting for the presence of God in this world. And it is interceding in the lives of our loved ones. I want to invite us all right now to do just that, to vote for God, to vote for the presence of God here in this church today. We have a tradition here at Niles. In the pew in front of you and on the back of the pew, we have little pieces of paper that you can write on that you can write praises and prayer requests. You can let God know what's on your heart, on your mind. Tell him the things that are worrying you. And you can bring it up here to the front and place it in our ballot box, if you will. So that we can pray over it. My husband and I will bring this box home this week. We will pray over them. We will not see them. Only God will see them. But we will pray over them. Go ahead and bring them forward. For God to be our leader today, didn't we? Praise God for that. Let's kneel and pray. Father God, Lord, we come to you today, Lord. We come seeking your presence today, Lord, in this church, in our hearts, in our lives, Lord. Lord, we ask that you intercede in every part of our life. Lord, we know that life on this earth is not easy. It's not easy standing up and choosing you, Lord, and making ourselves a target for the devil. Lord, I want to pray that you would protect each one of us here today, that you would protect us from the attacks of the devil. Lord, you know that each one of us is going through trials in our lives, Lord, that might be sickness, that might be finances, Lord, that might be work or family members, Lord. We don't know. Each person has a trial that they're going through, Lord, or maybe multiple trials. And I want to pray that you would be with each person, Lord. you would guide them through this time. Lord, there are many of these praises, but specifically prayer requests that we have placed in this box, Lord. We're asking for you to intercede. We are voting for you in our lives, Lord. I pray that you would be our good leader, Lord. We know that you are the only perfect leader. We praise you that you are leading in our lives every day if we allow you, Lord. Lord, I pray that you would be with Pastor as he speaks to us shortly. Lord, that you would place the words on his mind, Lord, that can inspire us to draw close to you. Lord, bless us with the knowledge of you. Help us to draw close to you and to know you, Lord. We love you, and I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Beauty of nature unfolds.
From the darkness came.
Thank you so much for this special music. I am so grateful to see this many children in our church. Praise the Lord. They come here for children's story. They feel the stage, and there's almost as many sitting there ready to perform. Amen? What a blessing to see. And as they collected the children's offering, one of the children came up to me and said, "We ran out of buckets, Pastor. We ran out of buckets." What a good problem to have. I praise God for that. I would like also to say a word of appreciation to our God and Savior for giving us such a wonderful gift of the weather last week. Amen? Did you enjoy it? Isn't that a blessing to enjoy God's creation? And we will continue our worship focusing on the Word of God. Yes, one more thing. We would like not to forget to say a word of appreciation to the people that set up the stage. They wanted to make sure we have some pumpkins here. They look beautiful. So thank you for arranging all of that. Now, irresistible sway of Jesus Christ. I drive towards the church, and on the left side and on the right side, I do have some fields, and one of those fields has watermelons. Have you seen those fields in Michigan that have watermelons? We didn't usually pay too much attention to them. We just buy them, we eat them. But this man just decided to meditate more a little bit watermelon. So William Jennings Bryan, he was an American lawyer, orator, and politician. He served in the House of Representatives and also as a Secretary of State under Woodrow Wilson. A little more facts about him, and prominent person. They called him the boy orator. So he was known for his wonderful speeches. So he said, "I was eating a piece of watermelon some months ago when I was struck with its beauty. I took some of the seeds, dried them up, and weighed them. And this is what he found. It takes about 5,000 seeds to weigh a pound." 5,000 seeds. And then he applied some mathematics to that. Let's say a good size watermelon that reaches the size to up to be like about up to a 40-pound watermelon. Now, it would take, you just apply the calculation 5,000 by 40, and you have 200,000 times the seed grows more than its weight 200,000 times, and then we have this beautiful watermelon that we enjoy. It's amazing, and he was asking these questions: who drew the plan by which that little seed works? Where does it get its tremendous strength? Where does it find its coloring matter? Where does it collect its flavoring extract? How does it develop a watermelon? And that's when he said, until you can explain a watermelon, do not be too sure that you can set limits to the power of Almighty and say just what He would do or how He would do that. So, anyway, the title for today, this irresistible sway of Jesus Christ. And we will talk today about another parable that we find in the Word of God. And it also involves some growth. It involves some seeds, the process of growth, and also another parable that is one verse, by the way, you found it in the Bible, one verse, and it has an underlining point of this first verse. Parable. So these two parables, they are parallel to one another. They are not similar in their essence. They prove different points that Jesus wants to make. And the point is that out of something insignificant and small, God is able to produce a great result. And that is what we will find in the reading. Matthew chapter 13, verses 31 and 32. If you have your own Bible that you'd rather prefer to read on your device or as a hard copy, you're welcome to do that. We will have it on the screens as well. And now the parable he put forth to them, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed, which a man took and sowed in the field, which indeed is the least of the seeds. But when it is grown, it is greater than the herbs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and rest in its branches." So I was able to find this kind of a nice picture of a mustard seeds next to its flower, and it's amazing how small those seeds are. The point of both parables is that the mighty kingdom everyone expected could issue from apparently insignificant, indistinct beginnings, but later on it grows. Scholars, until this day, they dispute, okay, what exactly Jesus meant by a mustard seed? What is the mustard plant? You know, somebody has placed that mustard seed on the tip of a finger, and this is how insignificant and small it looks. With all of that, I would like to say that Jesus did not speak from a standpoint of biology. He was not a biologist to say this is the smallest in the universe, because as we know in the world of biology today, I don't know if Peter is here somewhere, then you would know that the orchid seed is considered to be the smallest. But Jesus, again, is a teacher first. And he were to say, well, it just as an orchid seed is the smallest, you know, then his audience would not be able to understand what Jesus would talk about, because they are found in Amazon forests, and the listeners of Jesus would have no clue what Jesus is talking about. But Jesus talks about the mustard seed, something that was known to the agriculture people as the cultivated smallest seed they know. And this is how big usually it grows, and it's not the biggest form of it. And this picture was taken in Jordan River Delta Plain from below Bethsaida in April of 2008. So mustard plant, it is still common in those plains. And Jesus uses this plant to make his point. So let's talk about the plant itself around the Sea of Galilee. It can reach the height up to 10 or even 15 feet. And it dies every year and grows back. And that's why when the comment was made about the plant that the birds can make their nest in there or sit on its branches, it is not true about the early spring when the plant just starts. It grows that big later on, and every year they renew themselves. If we go back to the Word of God, in the Old Testament, there are some instances where God is using the parable of a tree to illustrate the great kingdom. And in chapter 4 of the book of Daniel, Nebuchadnezzar had the dream of a great tree that represented him and his kingdom, that all the animals and birds that inhabited the earth could find rest under its shadow and in its branches. So that was a parallel to the great kingdom, something that that grows great. And in Ezekiel, in chapter 17, there is another illustration that is used by God, and it signifies that the cedar tree, as in Israel, the kingdom of Israel, it is an example of a kingdom. Now, we do have this illustration of a great kingdom represented by a tree, and Jesus uses that and connects it with a small, insignificant seed and says, this is how great my kingdom may grow when it has a good soil. So anyway, I would like to say that 12 or even 15 feet is no match to the height of a cedar tree that can be 100 feet high. And definitely, but that was not the point Jesus was trying to make. Jesus is making the point that out of something very small and insignificant, they can grow something very, very great. The mustard seed and the leaven set forth the growth of the kingdom despite many obstacles and issues, indicating its growth as recognizable to an observant eye. Something you don't even know exists will one day bring great results. And you might wonder, why is it that Jesus would use these two parables parallel to one another, and what is the point of him going that direction? Well, at this point of Christ's ministry, the opposition from the ruling class of Sadducees and Pharisees was growing greater. And Jesus and his disciples would encounter more and more oppression. Now, they would go as far as to make a decree that anybody that joins the movement of Jesus from Nazareth would be expelled out of synagogue. So, and the disciples, of course, they were kind of saddened by the fact that the majority of their citizens reject the message of Jesus Christ. They found themselves in great minority, and in this time, Jesus is telling his disciples, do not worry for the final result. My kingdom, even it starts like this, will grow so greatly that you would not even imagine. And that is a very good cherishing thought for us, that we don't need to worry about the kingdom of God and its growth. God is responsible for the growth of this kingdom. And when God is in charge, he will bring the task to its completion. And even let's say the kingdom of God in your heart would start from one good word from somebody that shared with you, one day the kingdom of God will be absolutely grown in your heart and mind. You know, also, it is another parallel I would like to use, speaking of a kingdom of God. Sometimes we share the words of God with those around us, and we don't even know how would be the effect of the words that we speak would be, and only eternity would reveal all of the instances that our witness of an even small word or deed produced something for the kingdom of God. We don't know it right now, but in eternity, God would be able to show that to us. Or sometimes you speak to a person, you spend with them so many times about the love of God, about the love of Jesus, and it seems like you're talking to the wall. The person is not listening to you. He doesn't hear, or she doesn't care about what you have to say about God. But time goes by, and one of those days you might get a call and say, do you remember you shared that word with me, and I had hard times believing it? Now I believe it with all of my heart. You know, one of the stories is coming from King Street United Brethren Church of Chambersburg in Pennsylvania, and is ironic fact is that this church is located right next to the Franklin County Jail. And, you know, there was an arrangement made in between the jail and the church that the services from that church would be translated by radio in that jail as well. Kind of an invasive type of evangelist. You want it or not, you got to listen. Yeah, something to learn about. Okay, anyway. So the fact is that this person, the young man, was in that jail. He was waiting for his death sentence because he had committed a murder. And pastor of that church, Pastor Clyde Meadows, he would go and spend hours talking to that man. And that man would always complain that his sin is so dark and is so great that never, ever he thinks God would be able to forgive him for what he has done. Now, he was awaiting for his death sentence for some time, and one of those worship services that were translated by the means of radio, he heard Pastor Clyde preaching on, "Thou your sins may be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow." And this was a verse taken from Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18. And all of a sudden, this young man, he just jumped up and he said, "I see it now." And he talked to the garden. "I see it now, garden. I see God will forgive me. He will." All of a sudden, all of those efforts, all of those words spoken before, they came to a match in his mind, and he realized that God is able to forgive whatever he has done, and from now on, he would be a believer. You know, and they applied for kind of an appeal for his sentence, and the appeal was declined. And on March 27 of 1938, he went to the death chamber of Rockview Penitentiary, and Dr. Meadows, as a pastor of that church, he was by his side as he was walking his last earthly journey. And this young man, he was not discouraged at all by the fact that his appeal was declined. And this is what he said. He turned to the pastor and said, "Reverend Meadows, one thing I want you to know. I want you to know that the gospel of Christ that you preach is real, and I'm ready to die by it." This soul was saved because the kingdom of God grew in his heart from something small and insignificant to full trust in Christ Jesus, our Savior. This is what Jesus Christ can do with anyone. My friends, when you share the good news, doing something for somebody or sharing the good, encouraging words, remember, even the small seed may grow for someone's salvation. Now, the next parable that is used, as I shared with you, is just one verse. And let's just read what it says. Another parable, he spoke to them, "The kingdom of heaven is like leaven, which a woman took and hid in three measures of meal till it was all leavened." Again, we see remarkable pervasiveness of a small agent, like a small amount of a matter would just permeate through the whole thing. And we would like to get to know some numbers here, right? Because I like to understand anything Jesus was talking about, what it would mean in nowadays. Three measures or seders, variously estimated as 20 to 45 liters, which could feed well over 100 people. So that is what Jesus was talking about a large amount of dough that, as baked, it would be feeding a lot of people. Now, you in the United States, you're probably not that familiar with liters. How much would that be? Let's just translate that. A bushel. Does that make sense? Yeah, a bushel size of a dough is permeated by just this little amount of yeast or leaven, and that is, getting into every essence of it and makes it grow big. So immediate contents is what is always has to be considered when we talk about anything in the Word of God, because usually, as we know, Jesus himself would use yeast or leaven as something negative when talking about the teaching of the Pharisees and Sadducees. And that's what we remember. Oh, leaven is not a good thing, okay? However, in the Word of God, if you go to Leviticus chapter 7, verses 13 and 14, you will read that besides the cakes, as his offering, he shall offer leavened bread with a sacrifice of a thanksgiving of his peace offering. So it could be used for good. So leaven is not always bad. The context of this story, it just tells us if it's something good or something not. So when Jesus talked about the teaching of the Pharisees and Sadducees, it had a negative connotation, that it is opposition that is Pharisees and Sadducees are doing. It's growing larger. But over here, the kingdom of God may grow from even something small to something that is great. And I was wondering how common was for Roman cities to have bakeries, and I realized quite often big cities would have their own bakeries. And you know, this is kind of a imaginary picture what a Roman bakery would look like. However, if you talk about the everyday life of a Jewish household, the proportion of bakery is not as great. Every family was baking their own bread, and as a result, every family was familiar with the process, how you have to knead the dough and how you have to put it in the oven, and then you bake your own bread. I love to bake bread, my own bread. And, when I came to the United States, I realized that you do not cook your bread. You what? You bake your bread, you know. And it's amazing that the process, the bread I like to bake, I know Jamie is a great baker here, and Katrina. The bread I like to bake is usually made of a rye flour. It's a very heavy dough. And I tell you, when I am kneading that dough, that day I don't need any workout anymore. I'm done, you know. It's a very heavy-duty dough that you have to work on. And actually, my judo coach, when I was a kid, he said, this is one of the best exercises to practice your good grip. That's what you need to do, is work on that rye flour dough. And actually, the effect of the yeast is not seen as significantly on a rye flour dough as it is on a white flour. Nevertheless, when this bread is done, it's extremely dense, you know, and it's heavy. It looks like a brick. It weighs like a brick. Usually I use it for food, but in case of an intruder, somebody breaking in your house, it could be easily used as a weapon. It would at least knock out the guy, okay, at least. That's amazing, you know. Well, so anyway, even I am familiar with the process of baking bread. And Jesus uses something that is very familiar to the minds of Israelites, and he is applying the effect of leaven on the great amount of dough to illustrate the nature of his kingdom. The key to understanding the parable of yeast, leaven, is to know that Jesus said to that that the woman mixed the yeast into a large amount of flour until it worked all through the dough. The little bit of yeast worked in the way its way unseen. So the process is unseen to our eyes. However, it is visible. The result is visible. Jesus works the same way. He permeates our entire life with his good news, and then little by little, he changes all of our life. And this parable, the yeast, is has nothing to do with evil. It's signifying some good spiritual work that Jesus is doing. And the point Jesus made is that the internal dynamic of rising of his kingdom opposed to the outward physical organization. His kingdom will grow through an internal and unseen spiritual dynamic. What does that mean? When Jesus was here on earth, he once spoke. Now, when he was asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, because they wanted the change. They wanted to dominate the world. That's what they wanted. They wanted to see some great changes. And this is what Jesus tells them. The kingdom of God does not come with observation. It kind of devastated them. That's not what they wanted to hear. But that's what Jesus says about his kingdom. I came here to install my kingdom, and my kingdom to an ordinary eye is not seen, but the effect of that is great. The idea is that the kingdom in some ways is hidden from our sight, is also met in the other chapters of the Gospel of Matthew in chapter 8, 9, and 12. But most significantly, the change brought about the king's coming was not the military, political takeover that even the disciples of Jesus were expecting to happen. They wanted to see themselves, and that's why they had this discussion among themselves of who of us is the greatest. It's because of this. They wanted to dominate the world. They wanted to see themselves as future ministers or kings or princes. But Jesus says, my kingdom is not what you think it is. In your understanding, you want power, this worldly power, and I have power over sin that is in your heart. I have power to transform your life entirely. I have power to make it within you the kingdom of God, and that is something unseen. And Jesus' kingdom took a spiritual territory rather than something else. You know, if you go anywhere in the world today, you will not find any place like where you would be told, oh, this is, by the way, a throne of Jesus. He comes here and he reigns from here. Do you know of any country or any place in the world like that? No. Jesus said, the throne that I sit is where? It's in your heart. It's in your mind. This is where Jesus wants to be. And this is where my kingdom is. It is unseen, but it's definitely great. It is so remarkable, my friends, that as the Christianity started, it had to be working like leaven underground. In Rome specifically, it was in catacombs somewhere underground where the Christians were under great persecution. In other places, they would meet in the mountains, in the woods, in the forest, somewhere where they would be unseen by the Roman powers. However, with a little bit of time, this message of Jesus Christ has spread all over the world without cell phones, without airplanes, without any cars or any other means of transportation or media. The good news about Jesus Christ were known to the whole world simply because Jesus has power to grow his kingdom from something insignificant to something very, very big. So together these parables of the mustard seed and leaven, they pair up and they include the male and the female part of the audience. Agriculture was mainly the dominion of man. They were working out in the field. And baking the bread was mainly something what women would do. And to both of these groups, Jesus is talking and saying, by the way, my kingdom may grow from something insignificant to something very, very big. And that's what happens in our everyday lives. As soon as we let Jesus be our master and Lord, it's just a matter of time when he will take over and overshadow everything else in our lives. You know, I was thinking, okay, who would be a good example to talk about this small seed and then a great result? And I thought of Joseph Bates. You know, this being a young man, Joseph, he was instructed by his father to become a soldier. And Joseph didn't see himself as a soldier. He thought of himself as a sailor. And the first opportunity he had to be on a ship, he took it, and he was sailing across the world. And very soon he became Captain Bates, and he had his own boat. And you know, anytime you hear expression, the sailor's talk, you know that it's not the best talk in the world, right? It's not known for some good words. It's called a foul mouth or whatever. That's what Joseph had suffering from, and this is how people around Joseph suffered as well. However, he married in 1818 with his wife. Her name was Prudence Nye, and she played a key role in his conversion experience. She started with very small things, and she prayed for him all the time that somehow his habits of chewing and smoking tobacco would go away, and so that his speech would be clean. And one of those days, as he was taking off shore, he liked to read, and she placed a New Testament, a small little book, in his case as well, so that he would have an opportunity to read it. And as he was there, he just shared later on in his diaries that he didn't really want to read the New Testament, but it was out there, everything else he read already. Okay, let me just try it out. And this is the example how God is working, starting with something small. And by the way, compared to the Old Testament, New Testament is much smaller book. Do you agree with that? But reading through the Gospels and the other books of the New Testament, his life started changing, up to the point that he set aside his habit of tobacco, and he also changed his speech as well. It was no longer the sailor's mouth or something like that. And people that were around him, they couldn't understand, what happened to you? How did it happen that you are totally new person, my friends? And the answer is the Word of God, Jesus Christ, have put a seed of his kingdom in his heart, and it grew that he is one of the most prominent Adventist pioneers. Before coming to Niles Westside as a minister, I used to be a pastor for 4.5 years. I was privileged to be a pastor for 4.5 years in Allegan, Michigan. And if you go today to Allegan, Michigan, Seventh-day Adventist Church, you will see that a sign on the church of its date of with its establishment, if 1863, and my friends, that church was built by this man. You know, Joseph Bates was one of the founders of the church, one of the builders of the church. And right now, he is resting there in Jesus somewhere in the region of Allegan City, waiting for Jesus to wake him up. This is one of the greatest examples how something starts very small, but over time and grows and takes over. His influence over the believers was priceless as people got to know more and more about Jesus from him. So, when dealing with the kingdom of God, we would always be surprised by the ability of Jesus to permeate through all the dimensions of our life. Little by little, Jesus works with us, changing us into his own image. The two parables we just discussed are the examples of the power of God to overshadow everything else with himself in our lives. It may start from small and very insignificant up to the point that we are entirely the property of Jesus Christ. You may attend the church for many years and maybe are asking yourself this question: how do I know that the kingdom of God is growing in my heart? And those of you especially who have been attending for a longer time sometimes are in this doubt. I don't even see the change in my own life. I'm a sinner. I'm a wretched sinner as I was. So how do I know that the kingdom of God is taking over my heart or not? Dear friends, I have some good news for you. Do not let your hearts be troubled. God is responsible for the final results. And in the epistle to Philippians, we will find an encouragement. The one that have started the good work in us will bring it to completion. And also, I would like to remind all of us, doesn't matter whether we are walking one day with Jesus or we are attending and active church members for 70 years. Jesus does not impose that many rules on us. He is asking of us just of one thing. Would you please let me in your heart now? Do you agree with that? That's the only thing he asked. For the us living at the end of times, that's the only thing he's asking. Would you let me in your life now? And it doesn't matter if you know Jesus only one day or 70 or plus years, the rule is the same. You let Jesus in your life now, the kingdom of God is growing in your heart right now. The Jews rightly understood that the arrival of a kingdom of God would create a tremendous change. And they were right in that. However, they made an error in their expectations of the kingdom of God. They expected that the Israel's greatness would grow to such proportions that now they all over the world would be recognized as a new rulers and kings in this world. And Jesus says, I came to make a tremendous change, but that is in your heart. I came to install the image of God in your heart right now. And let's not make that mistake that unfortunately Pharisees and Sadducees have made, expecting that God would somehow make us the rulers of this world. I know many Christians today expect the same as Israelites, that God would be involved in this day's political agenda. You know, it's time of elections right now. And, you know, there's so much debate about what party to join and who to vote to. And that brings anxiety and bitterness to a relationship and even division within one family. It may, but it doesn't have to, because Jesus Christ did not come to install a new political agenda. Amen? You know what Jesus came for? He came for you. He somehow decided he does not want to have eternity without you. And to the point that one day he took the penalty of death on the cross of Calvary for you and me. I don't know why he loved us so much. When I look at this world, I don't understand that love. Why would you love somebody that much that you would lay your own life for their salvation? But the fact is, he did it. And he did it when we were still sinners, without regret. And today, just as a courtesy, he is asking, would you let me in your heart now? Would you let me build my kingdom in your life? Would you let me to restore the image of God in you? And let it be starting small with something insignificant. Be sure, one day everyone will be surprised how the God was able to rebuild in you such a wonderful kingdom of God. Coming back to William Jennings Bryan, the one he ate the watermelon and started asking himself questions about the watermelon. Because I usually eat watermelon, I don't care about some other interesting details. But he weighed that one seed and he realized that in 1 pound, there's about 5,000 seeds. And then he applied that to a 40-pound watermelon and he realized that this seed produces the product that is 200,000 times heavier than the seed itself. He was amazed, and this is what he said: until you can explain a watermelon, do not be too sure that you can set limits to the power of the Almighty and say just what he would do or how he would do it. My friends, our God is amazing. He can transform and change your life, starting with things like insignificant and small. All you need to do is just let him in. Would you let him in now?
Closing song.
first the kingdom, 'tis your Father's will. So the voice of Jesus bids us follow still. Savior, we would hear thee, follow, find, and see. And in life's adventure, thy disciples be. As the silent leaven works its secret way, or as grows the seed grain through the night and day, Lord, so be the increase, peaceable but sure, of thy word within.
Let's bow our heads for prayer. Dear Jesus, we are so grateful that you came to set us free and build a new kingdom in our own hearts. Lord, without you, we cannot do anything with our own lives, with our own sin, and we ask that you would come into our hearts and reign there. Please take over all of our life. Remove everything that you don't want to see there and install things that are of your eternal kingdom. Bless us in this as we go and face another week, and help us share the good news of you with those around us. In Jesus' name, amen.